premises before I start. The first one is that, of course, I'm here by myself with the president, but clearly a biennial is nothing that is done by one person or two people. It's a really collective exercise, and so I really want to thank particularly the team of the Biennale and also my team in New York and many other people that are helping and participating. And ultimately, I also want to thank the artists and their representatives because they're really doing much more than usual to bring together this exhibition. The second premise that I want to make, actually, I should also say that it's great to be back in Berlin, and if I'm doing Venice, it's a lot thanks to my experience here with the Berlin Biennale. So many of the people in the team are here, so I just want to say hi to them and thank them as well. The second premise is that I'm going to try to go through 60 slides, and while it's a very excessive presentation, which is appropriate because it is an exhibition about excess of some sorts, I also want to remind you that what you're going to see today is really just a thin slice of the exhibition and a very peculiar perspective of the exhibition. There are many surprises and many other information that I'm not sharing today and that I hope you will come and see in person in June or at the end of May for the vernissage. The exhibition, as the President Baratta has already mentioned, takes its title from this strange object behind us, which is il Palazzo Enciclopedico, in English the Encyclopedic Palace, which was created by Marino Oriti, who is the gentleman you see next to it. Marino Oriti was an Italian immigrant to the United States. Maybe I sort of sympathize with him because of my own biographical experience. And Marino Oriti lived in the countryside of Pennsylvania. He was a car mechanic, but he spent his life building the model for a museum that would house all worldly knowledge. His idea was that this museum would collect everything that pertained to knowledge from the wheel to the satellite, as he said. He was meant to be 700 meters tall, 136 floors, and he should have occupied 16 blocks in the city of Washington. Obviously, he never realized it, but he was so convinced of his vision that he even submitted a patent at the patent office in 1955. So I think he's the only architect I know that has been patented. The dream that this object encapsulates is the dream of all of universal, all-embracing knowledge. And it's a dream that animates the history of art and the history of humanity throughout the century. I'd like to quote a sentence from Plato and his Timaeus, and says, "Nothing is sweeter than knowing everything." And I think from this dream of universal knowledge, many artworks and many objects and many flights of the imaginations have originated. I chose this image and this object, which is going to be opening the exhibition in the Arsenal, because I thought it encapsulated many of the themes that pervade the exhibition. The Encyclopedic Palace is an exhibition about knowledge, about the desire to know, and about the point in which this desire turns into an obsession and into a delirium. Aureti's palace was ultimately an imaginary museum, and this exhibition does talk about the imaginary and about the domain of imagination. How do we give form to the images in our head is one of the main questions that offers the foundation for the show. What is the space left for internal images, for what Hans Belting calls internal images, the images that are in our head, in a society that is more and more colonized by artificial and exterior images? The exhibition combines historical works and contemporary works. It includes objects that were necessarily not born as artworks, along with new productions by contemporary and living artists. This spans approximately 110 years of history, stretching from the beginning of the 20th century until today. It brings together more than 150 artists, and actually, just for the record, the list of artists that you have in your hands is not completely done. Don't come up after the conference asking to be in it. It's not completely done, meaning that there are some details we're working out. And includes, as I say, more than 150 artists from 37 countries. I thought of this exhibition more as a temporary museum than as a traditional biennial, which means that the choreography in itself of the show and the way in which it's spatially organized, I think, will point to the grammar of museums more than to the grammar, visual grammar of that of biennials. Another very important element, which is perfectly symbolized by the inclusion of Maurino Vitti, is that this exhibition blurs the distinctions between professional artists and amateurs, between insiders and outsiders. Ultimately, it's an exhibition about the autodidact, about the self-taught, and provocatively, he wants to prove that everybody is a self-taught. And as the character in Sartre's nausea, the self-taught, the autodidact, is an incredibly fascinating person that knows everything, but has trouble organizing knowledge and has to go through life and through information, trying to find a system and a scheme that could organize the world around us. That's ultimately, I think, what we do every day, particularly today in a society that is more and more under siege by a deluge of information. It's an exhibition also that takes an anthropological approach to images. As I say, it's an exhibition that doesn't necessarily distinguish between what is an artwork and what is not, that is more preoccupied with figurative expressions than identifying masterpieces. Ultimately, to summarize, I would also say it's an exhibition about visions, about what we see when we close our eyes. At its epicenter is this very extraordinary object, and again, this is not listed in your press kit because we got the confirmation just 2 days ago, and it's really a privilege to be able to include Carlo Gustav Jung's Red Book. I don't know if you're familiar with this object. It's a manuscript on which Jung worked for more than 15 years. He started in 1913, so there is a nice symmetry, and he kept it secret throughout his life. Actually, it's been only printed a couple of years ago because Jung himself was very concerned and jealous of this strange object, which is a manuscript that looks like an illuminated manuscript from the Middle Ages, but it's been carefully painted and drawn by Jung himself. It's a book that contains his dreams, his premonitions, his visual obsessions, and it's a book that, according to Jung, sort of contained the cipher of his own practice and also of his own vision of the world. This object is the starting point for a series of work that, particularly in the Italian pavilion, deal with the representation of the invisible. Here are two works by Imaf Klim, whose show I think will also come to the Burger Bahnhof here in Berlin. A self-proclaimed medium, she claims she painted these cartographies of the universe under the control of voices that spoke to her and told her how to paint. The work of Augustin Lesage, who was a hero of the surrealist, and he was a painter that painted these large sort of altar pieces, and he would paint them from left to right as if he was writing it. Sort of private, automatic representation of the world, and he actually called them symbolic representation of the universe. We are including also a series of drawings by Alistair Crowley. These are the mock-ups for his famous deck of tarots. So the idea of premonition and the idea of how we visualize the future and the invisible, and what we don't know, is a recurring theme throughout the show. Lisa is an example of the work of Friedrich Schroeder Sommestein, another artist that was very much loved by André Breton and the Surrealist, and who spent his life making this very cryptic, private cosmologies again. And the show sort of spans between these very private mythologies, to quote the gentleman of a few years ago, to religious iconography. These are also quite special inclusions in the show. It's a series of shaker drawings. They are called gift drawings because the shaker community believes that they are appearing in vision to the artist who draws them. And we are very lucky to have a small selection from one of the shaker communities in Massachusetts. These are drawings actually by shamans of the Solomon Islands, particularly the one on top. It's a drawing made by a person that for the very first time is asked to make a drawing. So in a civilization that is completely non-figurative, where there is no paper and no pen, this shaman draws for the first time his dreams and his gods. And I think it's a quite touching, actually, moment of revelation of the internal images. I mentioned cosmologists and cosmographers, the work of Guo Fengji, who unfortunately passed away a few years ago. She, again, was a self-proclaimed healer, and she started making these self-portraits and these drawings to cure herself from cancer. Unfortunately, it didn't work. But she also made these drawings to influence the cosmos and influence the universe. In fact, we are presenting a small series of her drawings that she made to stop the epidemic of SARS. As I mentioned before, the distinction between a conscious outsider or a professional artist is often blurred, and I think Jean-Philippe Schneider is a beautiful example of an artist who's very much part of our needs of the contemporary art world, but has sort of called himself out. When I invited him, he asked me if it was a show in which only artists would be able to participate, because he doesn't do email, he doesn't have a fax, and he doesn't answer the phone. And so we started a wonderful epistolary relationship that finally is ending in a very special presentation of his work. The representation of the invisible, as I said before, is one of the recurring themes, and this is a piece by Anton Zenyensky that was realized a couple of years ago, and that we're presenting in an exhibition in which a group of blind people is asked to paint the world as they see them, and strikingly enough, they see the world exactly as we see, which I think questions very much what we know and what we ignore. This sense of cosmic stupor recurs throughout the exhibitions, as in the paintings of Thierry de Cordier, who's been painting the North Sea over and over again for many, many years. Melvin Monti, of whom we present two films, and this is a detail of a film in which the artist films fragments of uranium, and so the show sort of spans from the microscopic to the macroscopic. These are works of Ron Nagel, an artist from LA, who makes these ceramics before falling asleep. He calls them sleep studies, and these are the forms that emerge from his mind in a state of near sleep or in a state of semi unconsciousness. Obviously, this is the work of Alexander Kohn, so I'm going to skip a little quicker through it. Geta Bratescu, these are a series of embroideries. Geta Bratescu is an artist from India who was very influential in her own country. She's now, I believe, 90, and throughout the show there is a strong presence of senior artists, and I felt it was important in the Biennale not just to go after the younger artists, but to include the artists who have been operating, often also outside necessarily the recognition of the market, and continuing to do their work. So in fact, if you're interested in statistics, I think we have over 40 dead artists. This might seem unusual today, but if you look at the history also of biennials, particularly of the Venice Biennale, it's only a very recent tradition that imposes the biennial to be preoccupied only with the young artists or with the state of art. Today, if you look back at its history, it has always been an exhibition that interrogated the past and that interrogated the canon. The theme of self-portraiture, of course, as a path to knowing oneself is very present in the exhibition. Maria Lasnik and Marisa Merz, two iron ladies, as I like to call them, will be placed in near proximity in the central pavilion. Practice of the imagination through writing and literature is another of the axes that runs through the show. So what you see here is an example of drawings by Christiana Soru, who illustrates for the exhibition the book of imaginary drawings by Borges. Borges is, together with André Breton, a sort of patron saint for this exhibition. Roger Carroix, the former surrealist writer who collected stones throughout his life, is going to be included in the show in his collection of stones that is going to be shown for the first time outside France. These were stones that, according to Carroix, sort of capture the earth being an artist itself, so a form of creativity that somehow belongs to the universe and not to humans. And speaking of trying to understand the universe, a strong presence will be a series of drawings by Rudolf Steiner, which might cost my career. it's 40 drawings on blackboards. As you know, Rudolf Steiner was a sort of a compulsive lecturer. He held more than 5,000 lectures throughout his life. Apparently, he would give lectures when workers were on their free time, their break. He would just go to them and give lectures about butterfly or about the universe. And his basically slides for his lectures are preserved in Dornach, and a presentation of 40 blackboard drawings will be included in the biennial. Other obsessions and other sort of compulsive behaviors are at the center of the show. Peter Fritz, an insurance clerk who spent his life making models of imaginary houses, Paolo Baratta, who I'm sure some of you remember also from his recent exhibition, again at the Burger Bahnhof, and Achille Serizzoli, an Italian-American who in San Francisco made these architectural drawings that he claimed were actually portraits of people. And one of these two is actually, not one of these two, but we're also including a portrait of his mother as a cathedral. Accumulations and collections are clearly also ways in which individuals try to organize information and knowledge and also to create microcosms in which to live. And Shinro Taka is a Japanese artist of whom we're going to present this complete collection of scrapbooks in which he collects images and sort of organizes a private library that again resembles the library of Babel. Carl Andre, of whom we are very pleased because we're not showing one of his more well-known sculptures, but this exceptional piece called Passport, that it's a sort of self-biography through images. And Walter Pickler, who is another very special artist who unfortunately left us last year, and who spent his life making these sculptures and building houses for them, sort of creating an alternative universe in which his own sculptures could live. The Arsenale is organized thematically, loosely around the progression from natural forms to artificial forms, which was the way in which Wunderkammer were originally constructed, and so you represent a progression from the realm of the natural, from the role of the artist to understand the secret code of nature until the artist being confronted with information. This is the work of Okeyo Jekere, a Nigerian artist who has built an incredible archive of hair dues from Nigeria. Lin Su, a Chinese artist who goes around in his walks taking microscopic views of nature. Christopher Williams with a series of photos from the Glashka models. These were glass models built at the end of the 19th century to represent. To be used in universities actually for teaching biology. Elliot Porter, a photographer from the National Geographic, who developed a system to take pictures of birds with their wings spread. The idea that art can allow us to see more and to expand our vision is one of the foundations of the show. So for example, Edward Spergerini was a balloonist. He was the first man that took an aerial photograph of the pyramids, and he took a beautiful photos of the Alps because he could fly above 3,000 meters of altitude with his balloons, and there's going to be a small selection of his work. Yüksel Arslan, a Turkish artist now living in Paris, who's been composing a sort of private encyclopedia of humanity. The idea of large cycles of works is very crucial to the exhibition, what the Latins used to call the summa. And Arslan is certainly an author of such summa, and we're also including the complete illustration of the Genesis by Robert Crumb. Shinichi Sawada is a young artist from Japan who's composing a sort of private bestiary. Papa Ibra Tol from Senegal, basically the founder, I think, of Buddhist contemporary art in Senegal, but never shown in Italy for sure, who recently had a tribute at the Dakar Biennale. Present a selection of his drawings and tapestries that often deal with creation myths and legends. And of creation myths, also Camilla Rowe will be talking about in a new slideshow and video that investigates the ways in which humans build the narrative of origin of the universe. Neil Belufa, in his video, looks at the way in which we represent the future, and of Steve McQueen, we are presenting a piece of a few years ago in which the artist collects the images that were sent in space by NASA, the famous images that were on the golden record, which offer a sort of idealistic and slightly embarrassing representation of humanity. And I don't know if the aliens ever found this, but if they did, they probably decided not to come to planet Earth because it looked as a strange United Colors of Benetton universe. And within the Arsenale, there's going to be an exhibition within the exhibition that is curated by Cindy Sherman. So I approached Cindy Sherman and asked her if she wanted to be in the show, and she actually conceived a show that we refer to as a dollhouse or an anatomical theater, a place in which different modes of representing bodies and representing ourselves are displayed. because I'm going to be banal, but the very etymology of the word image goes back to the Latin and to the idea of the death mask. The imago was the mask that was made of the dead people, and so the question of the image is very much related to the representation of bodies, and seeing this show includes different, more or less disturbing representations of bodies like Carorama, John De Andrea, Rosso Schillas, particularly a reflection on hyperrealism and the uncanny, Christian Anspelman, Philips Galimbo. In our section there are roughly 30 artists and around 200 works. And speaking of bodies and desires, Charmaine is releasing a new video that is a remake of Pierpaolo Pasolini's Love Meetings. So she's interviewing teenagers and various people in America about sexuality and desire. And somehow bodies also, the work of Ryan Tracarty talks to us about. And this is the beginning of the last section. I'm going to just wrap up a section of works that deal with informatics and digital representation. So the digital printed paintings of Wade Guyton, a series of collages by Albert Urban, Alice Chandler, Chan Horowitz, who was a pioneer of optical art from LA, and now is also in the late 80s, Simon Denny, Helen Martin, and Mark Leckie, who's making a new piece about epistemology and digital culture. Yurian Karan is a young artist who's going to present a video in which a robot perform an operation on a few bodies. And at the very end of the arsenal, just to close this sort of explosion of images, is going to be a piece by Walter De Maria that he chose particularly for the exhibition, and it's a sort of, as always in his work, a sort of calculator that in a way solves and contains all the problems in the world. Just a few other words about some pieces that actually populated the so-called Giardino delle Vergini, where various artists are staging performances and different theatrical works like Ragnar Kjartansson, Marco Paolini, who's a director and actor. And I'd like to finish with this image of John Locke, because in a way, maybe it's what the curator would look like at the end of the show, with his face made black by the slaps of the critics. That's it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Massimiliano, could you add a word about your selection of the Leningrad album by Evgenij Kozlov and how it fits into the concept?
This is a self-serving question, but I will answer it. She asked about a specific work which I didn't show, that it's called Leningrad Album, and it's a book of erotic phantasies by Evgenij Kozlov, and it's I think a marvelous display of again the power of desire and imagination, particularly when it comes to reinvent our bodies and our desires, and that's why this is important.
There you go.
Yes, from what I gathered from your presentation, especially the first part, is that you seem to follow an approach towards non-social science, which is more related to the art than to the laboratory. So my question is, why do you have this historic approach towards science?
I didn't hear one part which you said more related to the archive than...
Yeah, from the presentation, yeah.
Right, and is this new perspective already
two aspects that I want to underline by answering you is, on the one hand, it's just a matter of history and it's a historical fact. When you have to show a new movement, or you have to show a new avant-garde of a movement, all you have to do is to show it to the world. So, I mean, when I'm making Biennale or an exhibition whose main task is show what's on, discover movements, discover tendencies, that you can do it by showing it. These can be called exhibitions that are whose intention is to document the evolution of present time, present tendency. You can realize that it's already a few years, a few biennales that are not discovering movements. Something that has to be documented for the sake of documentation. It's therefore due possibly to this that the curators are looking and condemned. And because the world is doing, to some extent, whatever, and the personal choice seems to dominate the world around. On the other hand, we have that contemporary art that was a matter for the few has become a matter for the many. And the world has been invaded by objects that are classified as contemporary art. And a very serious problem as an artist to whoever wants to make a research, to make an exhibition, on what have I to do with all these incredible production works. It is then we came to the problem. Well, of course, we have to choose by quality. Then, after a few years, what is quality? Can you escape the qualification by stylistic elements and so on and so forth? And then, of course, once again, to curators tended to underline that since there is a difference, if we have to look at this widening difference possibly between the production of objects that are may to some extent be more famous for what they are than for what they tell us. And on the other hand, we have this. Once again, back to the desire to meet art in a different way. Just meeting art as a great experience, as a great personal experience, where the dialogue between the viewer and the work of art is an intense dialogue, where the visual emotion does add to the viewer, and where the visual emotion brings the viewer to participate to this sort of the creation of a new world, which is the intention of the art and the purpose of the work. So I mean, I'm not, all I can tell you, I mean, I don't want to, as not a critic, I don't want to extend my consideration beyond what I have been seeing and what I have been witnessing. What I have seen is that there is this, the need to underline the need to underline and the need to find the visual emotions that I am using. I call it this a minutical tension means an anxiety to know and to see more. This is art, but once again, I don't want to say that what is not, this is not art, and this is not my purpose. I always want to say that this is what I've been seeing as present of the Biennale, as an anxiety on the part of curators vis-à-vis artists, the works of art, and the incredible explosion of contemporary art that took place in the world and takes place in the last years.
History, why open it up to different professions is because you cannot buy a Leningrad model, you cannot buy a Leningrad model, you cannot buy the Alistair Crowley drawings. And you know, believe me, it's also interesting because if I were to make a show of young artists, you could raise the money in 2 minutes. If you want to borrow Carl Gustav Jung's book, it takes a little more diplomacy and work, and maybe that won't even be visible or appreciated. But yes, the premise of the show is, first of all, the art world is bigger than we think, and it's bigger than we know. And I think that's also what it's nice about doing this show in Venice, that there is my show, but there are other 88 shows on which I have, on many levels, zero control. And I think that's also an exercise in modesty that, that I think we should go perform. And ultimately, when I announced the title of the Encyclopedic Palace, some people were saying, oh, it's so like ambitious and mega romaniac. But I think within the Encyclopedic Palace, as an idea, there is an antidote, because it's the possibility of knowing everything. And so it's also a modest proposal that this show does not claim to know everything, but maybe just suggest don't know always the same thing. So,
but don't give it up.
Ready for the class?
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.